Go Mechanic, like so many other hyper-funded startups, had one mandate. A growth curve that looks like this, and growth at all costs. Now, the last few weeks have been interesting. They announced that there will be a massive fundraise. That fundraise didn't go through. There was then an announcement of a 70% layoff and some misreport financial irregularities. Now, what really happened? What's their business model? And what's the way forward? There was even this LinkedIn post by the founder. So let's find out in this video. So what's interesting about the Go Mechanic model is their business model. I actually personally found it really interesting. So it's very simple. People own cars and the cars need to be serviced, or you need repair parts to actually fix the car. I mean, maintenance is a big deal, right? So you have local garages all across the country nearby where you go, and you have some favorite garages that you go to either for service or some small parts. Now the problem is people may not trust these garages over here because they're mom and pop shops. Instead, people prefer going to, say, an authorized dealer. And because of that brand of an authorized dealer, the authorized dealer gets to charge more for the services and even for the spare parts. I think somewhere I read 40 to 60% could be the premium you pay for a spare part if you go to an authorized dealer. So Go Mechanic said, okay, why don't we organize these unorganized players by becoming the OYO of garages. So now you had Go Mechanic, this new player over here, I'll call that GM, which gave branding to these people, training if required for services, and even made sure they bought spare parts, I'll call it SP, from trusted suppliers. In fact, they bought it directly from the manufacturer, so they're genuine and the price is actually lower. So now, from the perspective of a user, this is great. You now have predictability on unorganized players. You have a brand guarantee to make sure that nothing wrong is happening with your car, and you're getting these spare parts at a lower cost. This makes sense, doesn't it? In fact, it did make sense, not only on paper, but actually when they executed it. Go Mechanic actually got a 2,500 car maintenance deal with Uber. So far you were thinking they're you and me as customers. They also have a very good B2B platform, allowing companies like, say, Zomato or any of these ride sharing services, say Uber in this case, to avail these services. A 2,500 car maintenance deal was big because it proved that the model is actually working. Now, I'm sure just like all startup founders, these guys thought, guys, we've hit the jackpot. We're solving a real problem. Users like it. We even have contracts to prove that the platform is working. But look at this chart over here. This is revenue. It went from 1.84 crores to 4.5 to 17.8, 68 and 100 crores. These are run rate numbers. This shows that that hockey stick growth that every standard VC wants, or is the mandate for every startup to do, was actually happening. And this wasn't the only metric that was moving up. You could see the number of garages were adding up. So it made sense. Number of garages increase, revenue also increase. Business model seems to be working. And just to say props to the founding team, this is not easy to do. Getting to 100 crore revenue in a really old industry and having 600 garages and what, 700 employees? More than that. And number of cities covered was 37. Number of cars serviced was almost 1.1 lakh in a single quarter. I mean, little round of applause for how they actually executed this. This is not easy to do. Now, while this happens, there are certain people jinka mouth starts to water, and we call them the VCs. The VCs say, okay, great, nice model, good disruption, good growth. We want to fund you. Now, here is where things change a little bit. And what I'm gonna do is, I'm going to remove this GM and add a hockey stick curve over here, okay? So now this becomes the company. And now we have a new entrant over here. So GM, and then we have now the new entrant called VC. Now the VC or an investor, could be private equity, could be anyone, wants to see this growth happen, okay? I'll call it growth. Now, This growth could be anything that they have privately discussed and agreed upon. This could be revenue for online stores, like say Paytm Mall, etc. It's GMV. It could be number of garages, etc., etc. So in this case, I think it was maybe revenue and number of garages was probably the growth that we're looking at. And that is very important. We have over here the brand raising 439 crores from Tiger Global, Sequoia Capital, Orias, and Chirate Ventures. I think that's how you pronounce it, Chirate. The last round, Series C in 2021, was 42 million led by Tiger Global, which is a very well-known VC across the world. They have a very large pool. So I guess 42 million is not such a big check for them in the perspective of their total fund size. But here is the problem, right? This curve is very unnatural. It cannot happen forever. And it perhaps should not happen forever. It doesn't work. Now let's suppose our growth metric is number of garages. Garages plus revenue per garage, RPG. I've made this revenue up as an example to explain what growth at all costs means. Growth at all costs. So what this basically means is that your revenue per garage and number of garages, these are two metrics, should go up in tandem exponentially. They should not go up like this. Okay? If it goes up like this, you don't get a high premium multiple. Okay? Premium multiple. So like all investors around the world, not only VCs, even professional investors, need growth to happen. If growth happens, they pay a premium on the valuation of the company. Pretty simple. Even you would do this in a public market. Now, here is the problem. If for some reason the number of garages falls a little bit, okay, and you do not have money to fund this, because remember, you are burning money every time you're adding a garage. I'll say this again. The model is built in such a way, you cannot have exponential growth along with profit. It does not happen. It should, but it does not. You need to burn money or lose money every time you add a garage. If you didn't understand this, ask me in the comments below and we'll clear it there. Now, as that's happening, let's suppose naturally you add some garages. Let's suppose you have 100 garages. Next quarter, you add, say, 500 garages. Do you think all the 500 garages will have high quality? Will the people working there be very good? Will the spare parts they get following the SOPs will be perfect? Of course not. You've grown very quickly. Maybe some people will not choose the right garages because they have a sales target to hit. 500 garage add karne, hypothetically. When that happens, you get dilution in the quality of the garages and help, and hence the revenue per garage. And when that happens, the market, the growth curve falls a bit. Now, this is the problem. VCs don't want to see this, and founders want a higher premium. So VCs aren't the only bad people. It's also the founders. They want a higher premium. They want high valuation. So because they want that, when this number falls, they have to manage it. So the only way to do that is either be honest and say there's a small fall, but we'll manage it. Thoda premium kam de do, valuation kam de do, we'll continue to grow. Or you just don't talk about it. You just don't talk about it. Now, this is where in retrospect, when we look at this, we say, yaar, misreporting kar diya, galat ho gaya, this is false. It is, but this is what growth at all costs means. Growth at all costs doesn't mean you let go of honesty maybe, right? So at least what you report to your investors should be true. So maybe that's what happened here. Let's delve a little deeper to see what happened. You can see here the shareholding pattern. The biggest shareholder over here is Sequoia, followed by Orias, Amit Bhasin, another co-founder, Tiger Global, etc. What's interesting is that Sequoia has popped up here again. I think they've had a really bad year. A bunch of companies not doing well. The biggest backer has been Sequoia. I wonder how they really think in their office.
Yo.
What's up, bro?
A startup hai. Funding chahiye.
Chal de di.
Par mera idea?
Idea.
Tere baap ko, dada ko, bhai ko, bhabhi ko, sabko funding dega hai Sequoia.
Achha, chalo, never mind. Let's look at the GoMechanic financials now. So we've already seen that the metrics are going up exponentially. Amazing work. But let's see what's happening on the money side. Obviously, they're not profitable yet. We can see that the revenue in FY22 was 90 crores, but the loss was 114 crores. You can also see other years in this graphic, total expenses and profit and loss. It's decently high. And you can see that it's a high ops business because, well, garages. So there's a lot of burn that happens over there. So if you look at the revenue breakdown, you can see three sources. One is the sale of goods and services, second is commission, and third is marketing support income. I think this is them supporting their garages and earning something from there, which also is a decent revenue actually. But if you look at their expenses, the biggest expense is obviously going to employees, followed by advertising. Generally, this is what happens. A lot of startups spend a lot of money on basic two things, at least tech-driven startups, employee costs, and second is marketing. Then we have the other costs over here as well. So let's look at the timeline of what happened very recently. So first, SoftBank and Go Mechanic started talking to each other. The deal was finalized in February 2022, and they were ready to invest 850 to 900 million at a 1.2 billion valuation. When I heard that, that's a very large chunk, right? Like 900 million of a funding of 1.2 billion is almost like an exit because kuch bacha hi nahi, like it's a very large percentage of the business. Anyway, but the deal got stalled in March because of the global crunch. Company started running out of cash and went back to SoftBank and said, we will lower valuation even further, but fund us. Then SoftBank says, okay, 30-35 million and the rest will come from another fund. That's Malaysia's sovereign fund called Khazana. Both of them together got EY on board for due diligence at a 600 to 650 million. I think this is the valuation number. Then SoftBank and Khazana got EY in to do the due diligence at a 600 million valuation. Then EY, which is the auditor, right? It raised multiple questions on financial reporting and investors pulled out of the deal. This is where things changed. This happened as latest as December 2022. The founder also admitted to making some grave mistakes, says the business audit, and then there were layoffs. So this was done in a LinkedIn post. And then there were regulatory filings by Pricewater, who had discrepancies shown in FY20 ka audit report. So out of all of this, there are three big red flags. The first one is suspicious other expenses. There is 100 crores plus, which is bracketed under other expenses, and it's not clear of what these expenses are. The second problem is inconsistency of numbers. After filing a report, they changed the loss number, which increased, and refiled the report. So that reduces a bit of trust. And the third big red flag is overstatement of revenue. It was found that some garages were found to have made lesser revenue than what was stated in the financials. Now, these three things is a big problem. Now, after all of this, something had to be done to keep the company going, which resulted in the 70% layoff because that funding didn't get through. What are your thoughts on this? Could there have been something that the founders could have done, or the VCs could have done, or the old investors could have done? Put it in the comments. I'd love to understand, in retrospect, maybe something could have been done differently, or this is just the entire game of how this works, and everyone knew what they were signing up for. Would love to know what you think. The other thing is that now they're trying a last-ditch effort to continue the company by selling it to another competitor. I'm guessing this would be like a Car24 or like a Spinny. Well, if they do that, hopefully some of the employees can benefit with some kind of exit and it's not a total zero. Because at the end of it, I personally felt the model was interesting. Maybe the growth at all costs, if it was not done, this could have become an amazing business over the next 5-10 years. It may not have happened in 1 or 2 years, but I think maybe that's fine. But pushing all the negativity aside, the founder actually was able to write this and post it very quickly on his LinkedIn, explaining what happened. You should definitely read that post. But what do you think? Do you think this was an honest mistake? Do you think multiple players are to be blamed? Or do you think that this happens every time there is a VC rise and fall of funding in the market? Is it a liquidity thing? Because we see this sometimes with public companies as well. Would love to know your opinion. That's the story. If I missed anything, please put it in the comments below. Everyone in the office is trying to understand this story. So the more information we have, the more we can learn from each other. See you in the next video.